also the way it works historically, I'll come back to that, is that, look, you know, if the fear of disease exceeds the fear of vaccine, then people will take the vaccine. But they take the vaccine and that depresses the disease to the point where people aren't very afraid of it. So now the fear of the vaccine is greater than the fear of the disease, and they stop taking vaccine and the thing comes back. And that's exactly what happened in historically with a disease like smallpox. There was an inoculation against smallpox, and when the disease flared, people took it. But then the disease subsides, people get complacent, they stop taking it, and the thing roars back. So it's a similar kind of cycle. And historically, vaccine fear has produced the resurgence of many diseases. In the United States, measles, and in Europe, measles, but others, pertussis, in some of the world, polio. It's a huge problem. And the other thing about it is, you know, there is this phenomenon people talk about, herd immunity. And the phenomenon of herd immunity is you don't have to vaccinate the entire herd to protect most of the herd. You just vaccinate enough cows so that the thing dies out. But if the disease has this R-naught number, the reproductive number of 2, you got to vaccinate half the population. So if half the people are refusing vaccine, that puts you right at the cliff of a second wave. So we just really have to get ahead of that and have to demonstrate, frankly, that it's effective and safe.
So in the political sphere, there's been a lot of debate about the cure, in this case, social distancing, being worse than the disease. What are your thoughts on those sorts of claims? And what do you think should be our measurement of success when it comes to combating COVID-19?
Well, I mean, I think that kind of talk is actually, I don't understand that claim that the cure is, the cure is worse than the disease. Social distancing is saving hundreds of thousands of lives. I mean, 25,000 people are dying. But if no one were distancing, the numbers would be astronomical. I mean, all the early modeling and very respectable, credible modeling talked about, billions of cases and so forth. I mean, it would be a catastrophe if we weren't doing social distancing. So I don't know what they're talking about when they say the cure or distancing is worse than disease. How can it be worse? To have, okay, you've got a delay in the economy. You know, yes, that's difficult for everybody, but it's not hundreds of thousands of dead. So I mean, I just think it's reckless talk by people who just want to go back to the economy, whatever the cost.
All right, Dr. Epstein, do you have a final message for our audience? Or phrased differently, what does our audience need to know right now?
Well, if I can, one other point about this cure is worse than disease. Some of the people who are arguing to suddenly reopen the thing are saying, well, you know, this is no worse than a normal flu year in which 30,000 people typically die in the United States. But first of all, we don't know. It could end up being, as I say, it's at the midpoint of the disease and we're close to that number now. But more to the point, that strikes me as just crazy logic. It's like we lose 30,000 people to flu, so let's lose another 30,000 to COVID. I mean, is that supposed to be like, it's batty to be talking about that. We lose 50,000 people in traffic deaths. Let's lose another 50. You know, I mean, we're losing more people. That's not a good thing. And it's certainly not, the cure isn't worse than the disease. Without these measures, we'd be in a much more horrible situation. So my message is you just got to stay patient and avoid getting a second wave going. That's the major threat right now. And premature reopening of the economy, premature back to normal mixing is just very, very high risk that that's going to happen. In the meantime, I think give your support to measures that help bridge the gap in a safe way. Maybe there's more telecommuting people can do. This immune test is a huge move. We need to really pressure to field that test and bring people back to work who can safely go back to work. And when the vaccine comes on as soon as possible, people, if it's demonstrated to be safe and effective, take it, and don't transmit all kinds of needless fears about the vaccine. That's really what I would say at this point.
Dr. Epstein, thank you so much for speaking with us today.
Thank you. Come on, yeah.
And that's a wrap on another episode of UC3P. Credits go to Sidhant Wadhera and Caroline Kobzanski for co-producing this interview, and to Sidhant Wadhera for interviewing and editing. Special thanks to Leishia Ducton at NYU for helping us set up the interview. Our assistant production managers are Arjun Mota, Olu Ogidan, Soumya Khatun, and Sidhant Wadhera. Our finance director is Donovan Harvey. Our publisher is Yining Wong. Our intro music is Knockout 2 by The 2B, and our outro music is Yes, Yes, Y'all by Matt Large. Our cover art was designed by Shirin Raban. If you want to hear more podcasts, check out our website, uc3p.org. And if you want to contact us, our email is theuc3p@gmail.com. And if you haven't already, please remember to subscribe on your favorite podcast platform. A special ask for today, consider also giving us 5 stars and a review on iTunes. I know it'll take a minute, but it would make a big difference for us, and we thank you in advance from the bottom of our hearts. My name is David Raban, and stay tuned. You can listen in now for our earlier episode on Harris students sheltering in place, and we'll be back next week with Anna Carroll on how the government should respond to the crisis.
Is that the Yoda quote?
What is 19 COVID? Like, rotten mangoes you have.
Maybe that's a great interview for next fall if we don't get anything. I'd like to interview a subject matter expert on the syntax of Yoda.